Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Dr. Chris Flower, and I'm the Director General of CTPA, the Cosmetic, Toiletry and Perfumery Association here in the UK. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the CTPA webinar on Brexit. I'm delighted to say we've reached our maximum of 100 participants taking part, so I do hope the technology doesn't let us down. We have a mixed audience today, and this is an open webinar. Because many of you will not know CTPA, I'll briefly introduce the association. We represent those who make, supply, and sell cosmetic products, as well as those who supply essential services to those companies. We have more than 175 companies in membership, from major multinationals to SMEs, and we cover some 80 to 85% by value of the £9,000 million UK cosmetics market. Our ambition is to be the authoritative public voice of a vibrant and responsible UK industry, trusted to act responsibly for the consumer. And we aim to be the leading trade association to provide value for money to our members and to deliver pragmatic solutions. Here are some of our activities. We have early warnings of issues and regulatory changes. We provide interpretation of regulation, and this is in collaboration with the competent authorities. We'll provide confidential help and advice on a very much a one-to-one basis. And we represent the industry via a one-voice approach. We also support cosmetic science and explain it to the media, to consumers and other stakeholders. And of course, there is the one and only The Facts About website. Some of you will be belonging to member companies of CTPA here in the UK, and some of you work elsewhere for companies that are CTPA members. If you work for one of our member companies, no matter where in the world you're based, you are eligible to access the members only section of the CTPA website, where, amongst other delights, you will find a dedicated Brexit page keeping you up to date with what is happening and what CTPA is doing. For those of you who are not CTPA members, you will also find Brexit and other important information on the CTPA public pages, but you will miss out on some of the key detail, of course, and your views will not be part of our representation to government during the negotiations. We are, however, always willing to discuss membership and the important benefits it can bring to you and your company. And details are to be found at ctpa.org.uk. That's the end of the recruitment drive, but it now gives me very great pleasure to introduce Olivia Santoni, who is Head of Regulatory and International Services here at CTPA, to lead us through the webinar. Olivia.
Thank you, Chris, for the introduction, and thank you, everyone, for attending this webinar today. As you know, although the situation with regard to Brexit is still unclear, we feel that it is very important to provide the industry with insight and clear facts on what we know at this stage. It is very important to understand that Brexit will have a considerable impact on the way we are doing business, whether in the UK, in Europe, and internationally. I always wanted to insist on the fact that Brexit is not just a UK issue, but it is a global issue. So let's start by the beginning, the UK referendum. The referendum was announced in 2013 by David Cameron, at the time Prime Minister, and in 2015 the European Union Referendum Act was published. This act established the criteria for the referendum, eligibility, and in particular, the question which was whether the UK should remain a member of the European Union. What the act does not stipulate, however, is whether the result will be used by the government for information or will be required to be enforced by the government. Under the UK law, the interpretation will be that unless it is explicitly stipulated that follow-up actions are needed, referendums are used for information purposes. The referendum was held in June last year, as you know, and the results were as below: to remain in the EU 48% of the votants, and to leave 52%. As you are also aware, there were differences in the result depending on the UK regions. Following the results, the Prime Minister announced its intention to enforce the will of the UK citizens and raise the possibility of using the now famous Article 50 of the Treaty of the European Union. Article 50 is a very interesting case. It is a relatively a new article. It has been added via the Lisbon Treaty and has never been used before. It consists of five paragraphs, describing the process to leave the EU membership. Before going into the detail of the process, I think it's always important to highlight the EU institutions that are involved under Article 50. You've got first the European Council, the European Commission, the Council of the European Union, and also the European Parliament. What is interesting with the European Parliament is that the withdrawal agreement that is described under Article 50 will be voted by the Parliament, and UK MEPs will also be included in the vote. This is not the case for the Council of the European Union, where the UK representative will not be able to participate, but for the MEPs, they will have a vote. Now, looking at the process of Article 50, it begins by a notification that is done by the state in question according to its national constitutional law. This is a very important point, as I'm sure you are aware of the recent UK court cases on this topic. Once notification is done, the format is not very specified, but we expect a written notification. Article 50 states that the treaty shall cease to apply from the date of entry of the withdrawal agreement, or failing that, 2 years after the notification. What I really want today to do is also to insist on the fact that the UK will still be a member of the European Union even after triggering Article 50, and will keep its membership status for potentially 2 years or more if the European Council and the Member State agree to extend the deadline. After a notification, the European Council will agree by consensus guidelines for the EU negotiation. There is, in Article 50, also a possible further stage where the Commission submits recommendations to the Councils and appoints a negotiator. You may be already aware that the EU negotiator, Michel Barnier, has already been appointed. The next stage is a negotiation that will be undertaken by the Commission and the negotiators in order to build a withdrawal agreement. This agreement will have to be voted by the European Parliament on a simple majority rule, and also by the Council of the European Union by unanimous voting. This means 20 out of the 27 member states. Some observation about Article 50. There is a debate on whether the notification is irrevocable or not. There are different legal opinions on this. It is not a straightforward answer, but what we can say is that the article does not stipulate that the notification is irrevocable. Also, recently, you may have heard from the BBC, the writer of Article 50, Lord Caird of Kinlochard, expressed his position and is in the view that the notification can actually be irrevocable. So at the moment, we don't have any clarity on that, but I would say there is two ways to argue this point. Another point to make is the statue of the UK during the negotiation. As I have already said, the UK will still be a member state during the withdrawal negotiation and will continue business as usual until the withdrawal agreement enters into force or 2 years or more after notification. And therefore, existing EU law will continue to apply in the UK. The UK will be forced to apply EU law. So the law will not change until we are totally left the European Union. Looking a little bit deeper in the content of the withdrawal agreement, and in particular how far the future relationship between the UK and the EU will be detailed in this agreement, I would say that although the article mentioned taking into account of the framework for its future relationship with the Union, any sort of detailed relationship would have to be part of a separate agreement because of the European treaty requirements when it comes to the voting system required for free trade agreement. As I mentioned before, for Article 50, we're talking about qualified majority voting at the European Council, whereas for normally free trade agreement, if there are deep detail inside, we will involve unanimity in the Council. So we will have to have a vote with unanimous number of member states agreeing to it. And also, it will require the EU Parliament consent. In addition to that, I would say, depending on how far the agreement goes, we can also expect national ratification. So it's a bigger, deeper process for a full future relationship. What we do know, however, is that Article 50 does not specify whether these negotiations should be simultaneous or consecutive. This will be a matter of the negotiation. So although the new relationship agreement cannot be signed before the withdrawal agreement, we would expect that negotiations on the future relationship will be done simultaneously. We can imagine a shadow agreement behind the scene to build the future relationship. But what about now the UK political landscape? As a UK association, we are now facing new ministers, new political advisor, and two new government departments, the Department for Existing the European Union, headed by David Davis, and the Department for International Trade, headed by Liam Fox. When I was talking about Article 50, I have insisted on the first paragraph, which said that the notification should be done in accordance with national constitutional laws. This is a very important point because we could imagine a situation where the notification is triggered in breach of the UK constitutional laws and therefore will not be valid even if the negotiation already started. The UK courts have been working on assessing the prerogative power of the Secretary of State to give notice under Article 50 of the Treaty of the European Union. The verdict was that the Secretary of State does not have the power to give notice according to Article 50. This is the power of the UK Parliament. The Supreme Court validated this verdict, and therefore the Prime Minister cannot trigger Article 50 unless a law is voted. Another interesting point of the verdict of the Supreme Court was that the government does not have an obligation to consult what we call the devolved government, so Scotland, Wales, and Ireland, before triggering Article 50. Of course, there will be informal consultation, but the court has been very clear on that part. As you can imagine, the government was very well prepared for this verdict, and on the same day, they have introduced what we call the European Union Notification of Withdrawal Bill. It is a very short bill providing the government with the power to trigger Article 50. I really want to insist that the copy that you've got on the presentation is not an extract, but it is the full text. So very short, very few possibilities to discuss amendments, and therefore, normally, we will have further information in February. So what happened next? So this law, the European Union Notification of Withdrawal Bill, has now been introduced to the government, to the Parliament, sorry, and we are expecting a second reading on Tuesday, 31st January, with some conclusion. So after that, we go again considering committee beginning of some concluding discussion on Wednesday, 8th of February, about the statute of this law. Another important development to keep an eye on, in addition to this law, is the Great Repeal Bill proposition from the government. The Great Repeal Bill is aimed at overturning the 1972 European Community Act and, in effect, take the UK out of the EU jurisdiction. The UK will then be able to introduce new rules domestically. The bill has not yet been released, as you can imagine. There are some practical difficulties due to the number of EU law impacted. Today, we are focusing on the cosmetic regulation and REACH, but you can imagine the number of EU regulations that will be impacted. So because of this huge number of regulations, the ministers have suggested that in the first instance, all the EU rules would be transposed into national law, a sort of copy and paste. Although for some rules this will be an easy exercise, for some regulations such as REACH and the cosmetic regulation, this will be challenging because of the reference of the European Community and the role of European body in the regulation. But before going into detail of the cosmetic regulation and REACH, it is important to understand the overall impact of the UK leaving the EU. It will have a big impact on business. The UK is the second largest market for cosmetics in the EU. 64% of the UK cosmetic export goes to the EU. But also, and this is why it is important to stress that Brexit is not just a UK issue, 66% of the UK imports for cosmetics are coming from the EU, with top importers being France, Germany, Italy, Poland, Netherlands, Belgium, Spain, and Irish Republic. When we looked at the challenges of the Brexit, it was very important for us to have a full picture of the different agreements linked to the EU membership. Leaving the EU membership will include not being member of the single market anymore, but there are also other considerations that are very important. One of them being the European Customs Union. Membership includes EU members and specific agreement with Turkey, Andorra, Monaco, and San Marino. And as you know, the Customs Union established no custom duty at internal border between EU member states, common custom duties on imports from outside the EU, common rule of origin for products from outside the EU, and a common definition of custom value. This regime applies to finished cosmetic products, but also to raw material. Therefore, being out of the custom union will have an impact on every type of business, and in particular when it comes to custom clearance. There will be delay, there will be costs, and there will be administrative burden. When it comes to custom duty, it is important to be aware that although at the moment I don't know what the UK will want to impose as a tariff for cosmetic and raw material, the European Union has bound tariffs at 0% in WTO commitment for the majority of cosmetics products, such as perfume, shampoo, makeup. But it excludes certain categories, such as pre-shave, shaving or aftershave preparation, personal deodorants and antiperspirant, and perfume, bath salt and other bath preparation, which are at 6.5%. So the impact on UK products being shipped within the EU will be limited to certain categories of products. But it's very important to look at the indirect impact on all categories because of the tariff duty for raw material. At the moment, it's 0%. We could expect a 6 to 8% increase. And also, not only on raw material, but on other commodities such as packaging materials, gifts, and other goods. Now, if we look a little bit more on the EEA-EFTA membership, so the European Economic Area units into an internal market, we know about that. It's composed of the EU member states and three EEA-EFTA states, Iceland, Liechtenstein, and Norway. There has been a debate recently on whether once the UK leaves the EU, it will leave automatically the EEA. There are some legal uncertainties, and there are different legal interpretations. The EEA treaties has a specific leaving clause in Article 1 to 7, which requires notification and a 12-month timeline. A court case on this topic is ongoing in the UK, so we know more about that. You certainly know also that in order to be applicable in the EEA, EU acts have to be incorporated into the EEA agreement, more concretely into one of its annexes or protocols. And it is the case, for instance, for the cosmetic regulation and REACH. Therefore, under these regulations, the European Community scope includes all EEA members. One last point on the EEA membership. I think it's always good to remind people that the EEA agreement does not extend to the EU Customs Union. So therefore, leaving the EU will make us leaving the Customs Union, but being member of the EEA still means that you are not part of the Customs Union. So it's two different agreements on that part. Now let's have a deeper look into the cosmetics regulation. The UK has been following the EU cosmetics legislation for over 40 years. We know about that. The competent authorities have been very participative and supportive of the principle of the cosmetic regulation and the consumer safety. Once we leave the EU, there is no reason why the government would want to adopt a different regime. From the preamble of the cosmetic regulation, it is very clear that this regulation harmonizes the rule within the community. And also that several EU bodies are involved in the regulation. We can think about the SCCS, the European Commission, the different member states, the Working Group on Cosmetic Products, Standing Committee on Cosmetic Products, the platform of European Market Surveillance Authority for Cosmetics. Therefore, we can see that a copy and paste of the EU regulation into the UK law will be very challenging. Adaptation will have to be made to ensure that it is applicable. At CTPA, we have dedicated a strategy Brexit group, and we have identified some of the key challenges that will have to be addressed for the cosmetic regulation. The market surveillance and administrative cooperation, the location of the responsible person, the role and responsibility, in particularly when it comes to cross-border distributors, the product information files and the risk of the duplication of product information files, safety assessor qualification, and notification and labeling changes. Market surveillance and administrative cooperation is a key principle under the cosmetic regulation. EU countries are responsible for the surveillance of their own markets for cosmetics. And the aim of this network is really to facilitate cooperation by coordinating activities, exchanging information, developing and implementing joint projects, and exchanging best expertise and best practice when it comes to the cosmetic market surveillance. Because of this principle, cosmetic companies have the option to keep their product information file in one country only. So, the question is really, what will be the nature of the relationship post-Brexit? And this is a very complex question. This is not about single market or free trade, but more about collaboration and mutual recognition agreement. The responsible person location, I think this was one of the key issues we worked on once we heard the result of the referendum. As you know, under the cosmetic regulation, only cosmetics for which a legal or natural person is designated within the European community as the responsible person shall be placed on the market. So it's easy to identify the potential issue of Brexit. Companies selling both in EU and in the UK may potentially end up having to have two responsible persons, one in the EU and one in the UK. Another big impact will be the changes in role and responsibility for certain actors of the supply chain, in particular, as I mentioned, cross-border distributors. UK-EU cross-border distributors will be considered as importers if we look at the different articles of the cosmetic regulation, and therefore will be considered as the responsible person for this product. This company, therefore, we need to look very closely at their responsible person status. Is there a responsible person in the UK or in Europe already? Do they have access to the PIF? Does notification under CPNP has been amended? What are the labeling in terms of address and country of origin? And what are their liability? So for this sort of business, it will have a big impact. When it comes to the product information file, as already mentioned, one of the potential risks will be a duplication of product information file for business operating in Europe and in UK. As we know, under the regulation, for each cosmetic, the responsible person shall make available a product information file to the competent authority of the member state where it's based, as indicated on the packaging. We know that the PIF is not required for each member state, and only the particular member state is able to access the PIF for inspection. Once the UK leaves the EU, there will be a potentiality of having to hold two PIFs, one in the UK and one in the EU markets. So again, this we need to be addressed. It will need to be in different languages. And as we know, information under the product information files are quite sensitive information that you want to have control of. So really, in terms of a company that have already an office in a new country or in the UK, that would be easy to control. When you are a small company and you don't have enough finance to open an office in another country, this could be more tricky. So the risk really about the duplication of product information file that we can say is really about the cost, of course, because you will have to set up a new responsible person. You may have also some business that operating as a RP or contract manufacturer that will lose businesses on that perspective. New responsibility for distributor. The issue of cross-border supply chain again, because as we say that a lot of products are moving from the UK to the EU. Languages and labeling and notification changes. Maintenance, again, it's a live document, the PIF, so it's not just a one-off. You will need to make sure that the PIF is maintained in the UK and in Europe in the same way. Confidentiality, I've already talked about that, the potential loss of intellectual property control for all companies. And also, in terms of the UK, there may be more challenges when it comes to enforcement. We can imagine that if tomorrow we'll have to have 60% more PIF in the UK, that will include more resources needed for inspection, and also the difficulty not to rely on other member states for post-marketing surveillance. The duplication of PIF issue is not only about the paper, it's also about the content. And we just wanted to highlight also one of the articles of the cosmetic regulation talking about the qualification of the safety assessor. I think for that, it's important to know that once the PIF is located in a specific country, compliance with national law is required. So the specific interpretation of the safety assessor qualification will need to be fulfilled by the company. So this is again something that is very important to consider. Notification and labeling changes. When it comes to the notification, we know that the CPNP is accessible to EU EEA members. The UK will not have an automatic access to it. So the current notification will have to be updated for UK company with the new EU RP address if they are still selling in Europe. Without access of the CPNP, the UK may decide to require national notification. We don't know, but this is something that that may be required. When it comes to the labeling, we know that packaging will have to be updated with the address of the new responsible person, or even bear two addresses, one in the UK and one in Europe, for products sold in Europe and in the UK. But also the country of origin may be required. For instance, in the UK, you may be required to have made in Italy, made in France, made in Germany when you are importing goods in the UK, and vice versa. Product made in the UK may have to declare the origin of the UK provenance. These changes will have a cost impact on companies, but we are really worried about a potential cliffage. If no transitional agreement is reached before the UK leaving the EU, products on the UK and the EU market could be illegal in one day because of the wrong label or because of the wrong notification. It would be extremely detrimental for UK companies to be forced to recall existing compliant product should they no longer comply as a result of the EU exit. And this would be equally disruptive to EU companies which export to the UK. So really, we really want to avoid this cliffage and making sure there is a sufficient transition period. Of course, the cosmetic regulation is not the only issue for the industry. Other regulations will be affected, and challenges will be either similar or different depending on the rule. Which I think this is, again, it is our next big challenges for businesses. The situation is very similar to the cosmetic regulation, if I can say that. A simple copy and paste from the government will cause challenges because of the scope and the statute of ECHA, in particular in this situation. Once the UK leaves the EU-EEA, UK manufacturers and importers will not be recognized as being established within the European community and will each have to appoint an only representative in Europe. This will also affect people importing finished cosmetic products in Europe, because maybe they were importing from the US before to the UK and the tonnage have been registered, but when things have been done locally and you are importing the substance more than 1 ton in your finished product in Europe, therefore you may need to register under which rules. Companies based in the UK currently acting as only representative for non-EU-based companies exporting into the EU would also no longer be able to act in that role. What we know also is that issues that will need to be addressed include the statute of existing rich registration, not only the future one, and in particularly when the registrant and the co-registrant is a UK company. This is causing, as you can imagine, a lot of legal challenges because there is a lot of contracts involved in terms of the fees and the registration at the ECHA level. So this will need to be resolved one way or the other. But what will happen on the UK side? Of course, this is just a speculation, but we could envisage different scenarios. A mutual recognition agreement. This will acknowledge the statute of UK registrant and will avoid duplication and burden and disruption. But if we don't manage to get that, we can imagine a UK-rich regulation under which the UK will operate on a standalone basis independent of ECHA. And therefore, they will have to put appropriate mechanisms to replicate some of all the functions currently undertaken by ECHA. So they will create some sort of what we called a UK reach. This is quite worrying in terms of duplication work because a lot of systems has already been registered, cost has been involved by company, and to have to do that again a second time will be very, very, very a problem for the business, and also the duplication of generating data. So this is clearly not the ideal scenario, but this is what could happen if there is a copy and paste of the regulation. The Environmental Audit Committee of the House of Commons in the UK has recently launched an inquiry into the future of environmental law following the result of the EU referendum. And this one was dealing in particularly with REACH. And I think it's important for you to know what were the questions asked because it can give a hint about what the government is looking at. So one of the questions was, what principles should the UK chemicals regulation regime follow? What are the likely practical implications of having a UK-only chemicals regulatory policy for the environment, public safety, UK industry? And what are the key features should any new regime have to ensure that these are not compromised? So this is the sort of information the government is trying to collect at the moment. Because, of course, once we leave the EU, there will still be in place in the UK specific environmental law that will protect the consumer, workers, and the environment. So they need to work on that. But of course, REACH is not the only regulation that we need as an industry to keep an eye on. And this list here is really just a flavor of some legislation that we have identified that will cause similar issues, maybe sometimes different, easier maybe to resolve, or possibility to have changes involved. But it will be a lot of work to be done to make sure that everything is tackled. And this is where we think that the Great Repeal Bill, we first try just to do a copy and paste and then work on a specific regulation if there is any big problem. So thank you really very much for your attention. I do hope that you have found this webinar useful. Please visit our website and our position paper on Brexit that we have recently published on our public website. If you have any question, please email our info box, quoting CTPA Brexit webinar by Friday the 3rd of February. We will send the presentation via email. Normally end of next week, so hopefully on Thursday 9th of February, with a roundup of questions received, so everyone will be able to have a flavor on the different questions we receive either during this webinar or if you send it by email just after that, we will try to make sure we can give you sufficient information on that. Thank you.